This is Toronto. I wasn't born here, but have called it home for much of the past 28 years. A few years ago, I noticed that people don't believe in or respect even the concept of God anymore. So I decided to ask around. Eventually, I met six people I could talk to. I gassed up my car and hit the road. This experience changed the way I look at religion, and it changed my life in the process. My name is Sasha. This is Believers.
I met a guy I hadn't seen in a while, and he told me that he'd become an atheist because he'd watched Religious. So I watched Religious. I was raised a Hindu, and I found that some of the claims the film makes about Hinduism just weren't true. And when I did some research, I found that claims about other religions weren't true either. So I decided to do my own thing. And I had a few goals. I wanted to present each of the five major world religions faithfully. I wanted to stick to the basics. And I wanted to leave room for God to show up, with the awareness that if he didn't, that was an answer too. That was the plan.
Can you sum up what it means to be a Hindu in one sentence?
Hinduism is a way of life. And everything we do, we're thankful to God. Through the grace of God, we are here. Through his grace, we shall exist. Through his grace, we shall be rejuvenated, reincarnated. Without his grace, nothing can be. Believing that is a Hindu. The true Hindu believes that God is not in the judging business. God is in the giving business. There's a term that says, Bhagwan, God, Sarva Karma Faladata. He is the bestower of the fruits of our actions. Whatever we do, his job is to make sure we get the results of what we do.
So he gives or punishes depending on what?
No punishing.
Gives. So you're always receiving, regardless of whether or not what you're receiving is good or bad.
Then who interprets what's good or bad?
Well, I suppose it would be up to me to
exactly.
Interpret
now. He's the giver.
I see.
He's the giver. He gives what you want. You have decided what you want, and he says, if this is what you want, you choose, but you will determine whether it's good or bad for you.
Judaism believes that there are seven kind of basic laws of human behavior that all human beings are required to observe, like not murdering and not stealing and things like that. And they feel that the Jews are a chosen people in the sense of having been given extra responsibilities. And there are different understandings of what it means to be a chosen people, but the one that I'm most comfortable with is the Prophet Amos's understanding of what it means to be a chosen people. He says to the Jewish people, "You, only you have I chosen from all the nations of the earth, and that is why I will punish you for all of your sins." That it's an added responsibility that the Jews have been given a mission of being a light unto the nations, and that if Jews fall short, they are more susceptible to punishment than other people.
Buddhism is a vast philosophy, but to summarize the entire philosophy, I can summarize into three sentences. Avoid all that is bad. Cultivate all that is good. Purify your own mind.
Yeah, I think a Christian is restoring one's relationship with God through faith in Jesus Christ and what he accomplished on the cross, and entering into that spirit-filled different level of life that Jesus described as life in the kingdom.
In one sense, basically just means, as opposed to being a theist, which means that you believe in supernatural powers, you believe in God, an atheist is a non-theist, so basically I don't believe in gods or supernatural powers.
Do you have anything that you might call beliefs?
It's a belief in our fellow human beings, really. Having faith in our fellow humans, not in something that is magical or supernatural or like a fairy tale, basically.
The definition of a Muslim is somebody who submits to the will of Allah, or that is God Almighty.
When you say Allah, you're talking about the Abrahamic God.
That's correct.
So a person who submits to the will of a Hindu, for example, or a Buddhist, they would not be considered Muslim.
Actually, any person who associates partners with Allah or God would be outside the fold of Islam. So there is the concept of just one God.
When we spoke before, you said that Hinduism is a monotheistic religion with a polytheistic view. And I was wondering if you could explain that.
Actually, it's very simple. All of us in our lives have many roles.
Right.
And we have different roles, and the roles are relevant to different people. For instance, you, your mother will always see you as son, her son. Your fiancé or girlfriend may see you as fiancé or boyfriend. Your brother will see you as a brother, sister as a brother, your friend as a friend. When you are a teacher, you're a teacher, you're interviewing me today, you're an interviewer. But nevertheless, you are only one person. And each one of us who represent you, today I see you as my interviewer, and that's all you are today to me. Tomorrow, I may call you something else. You may come over to my house and you'll be a friend. But when you go home, your mother will never call you an interviewer. She'll say, you're my son. But each and every one of us see you from a distinct perspective for the relationship we have or what you offer to us. Similarly, in Hinduism, we know that God is only one, but we all have different needs. And based upon that need, we relate to an entity, to a form, or to a specific description of the Divine Lord, and we give him a name. It says, you who give knowledge, we call you this. But it's the same God who gives knowledge.
Christians and Jews would consider themselves to be aligned with the Abrahamic God. How would a Muslim view their religious beliefs?
As far as the Jewish people are concerned, obviously they do not associate any partners with God. But in the Christian faith, some denominations, or in fact I should say most denominations, consider Jesus Christ to be the Son of God, and we consider that to be a great sin because God is above these things. So those denominations would then not be considered in terms of submitting to the one and only God, then we would consider them not to have submitted to that concept.
As a Christian, we're taking the Old and New Testament as God's inspired word, and it's one story, right? Right from creation in Genesis 12 and Abraham and God's promise that he's going to create a people, and you see this great narrowing that happens over the progress of the story, right? He creates a people in Abraham and this nation in Moses, and he takes one tribe, Judah, and he takes one family, David, and then he takes one person, Jesus, and the whole thing narrows to this point, right in between the Old and New Testament, but then gets very wide again. There is an increasingly large circle of people that are meant to be included. So we have an element of inclusion, not exclusion. The point is to bless all families of the earth. So it really is headed to be an everyone thing, not an us instead of them. We still believe in all those things in approaching God, and it's the same God and one God. But something's changed with the arrival of Jesus.
I have no trouble with the claim that Jews were living with for 1,000 years before Jesus, which was that human beings have the power of redeeming themselves. That God revealed himself, God gave the Torah, the first five books of the Bible, as a law code to the Jewish people, and you follow that and you have the power of redeeming yourself. My reading of early Christianity, particularly of Paul, is that Paul was arguing that it's hubris to claim something like that. It's false pride to claim that a human being has the power to redeem himself or herself, and the only way that human beings can be redeemed is by an act of God,
right,
and by God dying on their behalf. And I just find this such a gigantic shift from the first 1,000 years of Judaism, yeah. And the Judaism of Moses and of Isaiah and of Amos and of Ezra and of Hillel, all of those great Jews who lived before Jesus came along, continues to be appealing to me. So Judaism that says that God gave human beings a law code and told them that they have the power of improving themselves, right, by observing that law code.
Why Jesus? Why not Muhammad or Krishna or Buddha?
Well, I just think there's some very particular things around Jesus that is different than even other religions. In fact, I might even call Christianity a religion in terms of a transaction. I do these kinds of things for God, and I pay for this transaction, right? Certainly we have our own ideas, but just recognize that all of those things, I feel anyway, all of those things are people reaching for God. And I think what I found in Jesus was God reaching for people.
The Quran is extremely respectful of both Jesus and Mary. In fact, the whole story of conception and birth of Jesus, we say, may peace and blessings of God be upon Jesus, because that's what we are required to say, because we consider him to be a prophet of God and therefore our prophet as well. He's dealt with in the most respectful manner, and Muslims are required as part of their faith to believe in Jesus' miraculous birth, to believe that Mary was completely innocent, that no human had touched her, that Jesus was basically the Spirit of God.
Everyone claims to their kingdom of God and thinks it's the only kingdom on earth. But we believe that there's only one kingdom, and it's not on earth, and it's not in heaven either. It's all around us. And you can claim your kingdom and your kingdom and your kingdom, but we believe in the bigger kingdom. Like Christ says, I am from my Father's kingdom. And what he wasn't talking about Rome, but he wasn't talking about Jerusalem, he was talking about the kingdom above. Similar. I, as a Hindu, believe that Christ was just a very, very, very wise and very, very purified and divine soul who has reached a stage of evolution as Hindus evolve to rising to the highest level of human existence. Mm-hmm. And a very true spiritualistic, he was definitely a seer or someone who is self-realized. Okay? And in Hinduism, if you're self-realized, you are God. Meaning you become one with God.
Personally, I would like to call myself as a student or disciple of the Buddha. I like to avoid all isms, labels. Buddhism is not talking about the Creator God or Almighty God.
Do you worship Buddha?
Well, we are worshiping the man who had become the Buddha. In other words, we are worshiping the awakening, enlightenment. This is a way of expressing our gratitude, showing our respect, giving our thanks, and at the same time, there is a psychological effect that takes place when we worship to the Buddha. It is also a way of allowing ourselves to evolve towards that Buddhahood or enlightenment.
Did the Buddha say anything like that that would lead us to worship him?
What you have to understand is that, of course, Dharma is the path. You had to follow the path. So the Buddha said, I am just the guide. I am the person who can give you the instructions. You have to follow the instructions, but don't expect me to make you enlightened.
Mm.
Buddhism is saying that if there is a God, the human beings have the capacity to attain that state of Godhood.
Atheism, obviously, so we don't believe in God, we don't believe in heaven, hell, so we don't believe in an afterlife.
Right, right.
My non-belief was confirmed in the Sunday school.
Mm-hmm.
There was a momentary lapse, and then I thought, that means there's no afterlife. Damn. I didn't think of it right away. And it was kind of fearful, because we have our egos, and we think we are what we are, and we should exist for eternity. And there's no proof of any of that. We share the same DNA as a housefly, so when a housefly dies, you think they're going to go to heaven? No. We're just animals, like every animal on the earth, and we all just die, and that's it.
If you want to understand the death, right? You have already died so many times in this birth. If I tell you, would you accept that? You have died, your cells died, even right now, you know? Myself, you, even our cameraman, you know? You are not the same person who came here one hour ago. At the beginning of this conversation, this dialogue, you had a different feeling, perception. But now, what kind of perception, feeling do you have? So what does it tell you? Your psychophysical entity is dying every moment. So what happens is that this body, you know, is going to die one day, but the stream of consciousness continues. It goes from life to life.
The Hebrew Bible does believe that there is something after human beings pass on. Mm-hmm. But you are absolutely right that this, it's almost irrelevant. It's true that we shall live after we die in some way, shape, or form.
Right.
But very interestingly, Judaism just doesn't make a big deal out of that.
And what makes life meaningful is relationships. All of us have some kind. We will have some kind of parentage. We may have some siblings. And that how we start out with a relationship within the family is one level of happiness. And then we extend it to the extended family, another level of happiness. And then we extend it to the society and community and job and country. And then we have this other relationship, the relationship with that entity above all of this. To the atheist, he will not ignore none of the other relationships, because he wants to live well, mother, father, brother, sister, friend, and everybody else, and all society and community, because being good to everybody, I don't have to believe in God to do this. So the atheist is saying, the only thing I am not accepting is, well, I gotta have this relationship with this thing you call God. But he doesn't call it God. He is seeing the goodness in everyone and the goodness within him, and by doing that, he is living the belief of God, because we believe in Hinduism that the greatest way to serve God is by having good relationships with humanity. We cannot serve God if we cannot relate to human beings in a positive way.
I look out at this world and at the beauty and at the wisdom of this world around us, and I just have to believe that there is a maker. Hard for me to imagine that the maker of this world would make it and then would just abandon us. The religious argument is an attractive argument to me, and if anybody who's willing to listen to me, I'll make it to them.
It is so incredible. You have to say, well, there must be a reason for this. I always find when I look at the stars, I feel kind of very small and almost insignificant, because there's billions of other planets. And we're just one. So I think people with our egos have to kind of create that there must be some supernatural power that started all this and that I'm part of it. I can't resolve that in my mind.
Are we not placing a certain amount of faith in science that it will provide the answers?
Yeah, it's possible, but why do we have to know all the answers? It seems like religious people always have to know an answer. If they don't know it, they'll just say, well, God did it because he works in mysterious ways. Atheists say, we don't know the answer. We're looking into it. And right now we're dissatisfied that we don't know. We just don't know.
The mindset that says that everything is solvable by human beings without recourse to God is a very modern kind of mindset. The legacy of the West and of the Western religions always was that human beings cannot solve everything.
Now, you just mentioned, so I have a master's degree in science. I'm a candidate for a master's degree in divinity. I love both these things. I love science. It's not my whole worldview, but it informs my worldview. What we've been able to learn by repeatable, observable things is tremendous. However, we both know that there are very important things in the universe that are not observable and not repeatable in certain cases.
Right.
I need some tools to deal with those parts of reality. Those aren't just aside from our materiality. Those are parts of reality. I can prove this to you. Say you're gonna go work at a company. You're thinking of having a career at a company. And I can tell you the numbers of the reality, the actual numbers about that company, what their revenue is, what their income is, you know, their profits, their numbers of people who work there and their location. Is that the reality that you need to know to base your career on there? No, you want to know some not very measurable things. And even maybe not even necessarily quickly observable things. What's the culture there? What are the people like? What's the attitude? How do things work? Will I be able to progress there? So these kinds of unmeasurable things are an important part of reality. And some would argue the more important for our lives part of reality, the parts that we can't measure that easily. And so I think if you just constrain your ability to things that I can look at and things that I can measure, you're going to miss the point on a lot of things. Like, say, love, joy, hope.
We need to understand that scientific discoveries are not without their own values that they impose on us. Forget about the major scientific discoveries. You take a knife. What immediately comes to your mind when you take a knife? That's something that you need to cut with, right?
Yeah.
So in other words, the value is embedded in what you discover, what you create. And so depending on where it comes from, if let's say a scientific discovery were motivated by religious values, for instance, as the Muslims would say that, okay, we need to create medicine because we see people are suffering from these diseases, then I think that's a very positive thing. Although overall, I wouldn't say that scientific discovery is bad, but what I'm saying is that I don't believe that scientific advancements have made need for religion or need for God redundant. I don't believe that.
You mentioned that it's time for prayers, and so they've left to go for prayers, which I think is pretty cool. My experience is, it's very Western, so it's been very, very, very interesting. Just pushing the boundaries just because we can just seems so pointless to me. And so his perspective, that I suppose the Muslim perspective, that there's a need that needs to be filled, so we'll fill that need with some kind of discovery is brilliant.
To invent something, First of all, you have to have a hypothesis, right?
Mm-hmm.
Then you have to gather data, right? So based on this hypothesis, after the observation or the experimentation, you can say whether your hypothesis is right or wrong. And Buddha followed this path. How did he follow this? Prior to his enlightenment, he was aware of this existential problem, the suffering, dukkha, sorrow, lamentation, pain, grief, and despair. And then Prince Siddhartha, Gautama, the Buddha to be, after having observed this, he got this hypothesis. If birth is, there should be birthlessness. If aging is, there should be aginglessness. If sickness is, there should be sicknesslessness. If death is, there should be deathlessness. If suffering is, there should be no suffering. With this hypothesis in mind, Prince Siddhartha Gautama renounced the world. Then he engaged in a series of experimentation under different teachers and also by himself. And eventually, he came up with his own solution to that existential problem.
Well, I think the rise in atheism is to do with science, because, before people would explain lightning and thunder with God, and as we're learning more and more about how things work, God is needed less and less. So from that aspect, it will help maybe people understand that God isn't required to live a normal, happy life.
I think our society is very material. It's quite natural to believe what you can see. So how do you deal with the things that are very real but they can't be seen? Well, you just say, I don't know. Right? I'm agnostic about lots of things that I don't understand. You don't have to know the answer to everything, and it's okay to have a too hard pile. You got something, you don't know what to do with that, it's in my too hard pile. Some of those things in the very difficult bits of the Old Testament, things that I don't understand. What happened? Well, I want to keep wrestling through that, but for the meantime, it's in my too hard pile. The moment you don't have a too hard pile and you start trying to give the answer to everything, I think you're in worse trouble.
We do not get into the question of whether man came from monkeys or not, because, by the way, we do believe the monkeys are very human. If you can turn beside you,
yeah.
Hanuman is there, okay? So maybe there's some depth to that, the evolution concept, but that is not a big question for us.
I don't think that the Torah was written in order to be a book of science, in order to teach me how the world was created. And it's true that the opening chapter of the Bible does tell me how the world was created, but the purpose of that chapter, the way it is constructed, is to tell human beings that they ought to be observing a Sabbath by saying that God created the world and he worked for 6 days and then on the seventh day he rested, and that's why you human beings should do the same thing. You should work for 6 days and then on the seventh day you should rest.
As far as Islam is concerned, it is not opposed to science at all. In fact, if you look at, you know, you go back into history a thousand years, some of the greatest scientific discoveries were made by Muslims. You know, Ibn al-Haytham was the inventor of the pinhole camera, on which our cameras and our television cameras and cell phones, all of these things are based. You know, Ibn Sina, or as he's referred to in the West as Avicenna, one of the greatest, you know, medical doctors of all times, his Qanun al-Tib was a compulsory reading in medical schools for 500 years. So Islam is not opposed to, you know, these kind of things. Mm-hmm. In fact, unlike the church, Islam has never persecuted any of its scientists. You know, poor Galileo had to spend many years in prison because he said that the earth revolves around the sun, not mm-hmm. the other way around.
Mm-hmm.
Islam has never had any problem with these things. In fact, if you study the scientific discoveries of Muslim scientists, you wouldn't find one example of a Muslim scientist ever being persecuted by anybody. So that's one dimension of it. But I want to come to the other aspect, which is that Islam also says that its message is not dependent upon scientific discovery for validation. Islam's teachings are based on divine law and divine revelation. They don't need scientific discovery to prove Islam's laws. But Islam does not in any way prohibit scientific inquiry, scientific discovery, research. It in fact encourages it tremendously.
All of the technology that's been coming at us is creating a greater need for spirituality.
Why do you say that?
Because I don't know if we know how to manage it. Just because you can do something doesn't mean it's good for you. Look at all, I think it's amazing that our technology is enabling us to connect on the level that we are. So Facebook now just hit 500 million users, right? 16 times the size of Canada. That's a lot of people. That's a lot of capacity to connect in a way that you couldn't if you didn't have that technology, right? Mm-hmm. Technology is just an extension of ourselves, extension of our eyes, television, extension of our feet is a car, right? So now we have the internet, we can actually relate, and we have an extension of relationships. Well, then you see people are get jammed up in these spending. You can spend all your time on virtual relationships. I'm not against it. I use it. I use all that stuff. But at what point is then real face-to-face intimacy become more treasured in the midst of all the virtual?
Modern society is hungry for love and compassion. It's hungry for good human beings. So the Buddhism is teaching this part, how to become good, how to become peaceful, how to become generous, how to be kind and compassionate to others. And as you can see, modern society is burning with violence.
The God of the Old Testament is arguably the most unpleasant character in all fiction. Jealous and proud of it, a petty, unjust, unforgiving control freak, a vindictive, bloodthirsty ethnic cleanser, a misogynistic, homophobic, racist, infanticidal, genocidal, filicidal, pestilential, megalomaniacal, sadomasochistic, capriciously malevolent bully.
the God of the what he calls the Old Testament. Jews don't like that term, Old Testament.
It's an attention-getting statement. I think it's succeeding in getting some attention.
That's his opinion. I completely reject it. I don't accept it at all.
The God of the Hebrew Bible is the person who told me to love my neighbor as myself, who inspired me to take care of the poor, and who taught me that ethics is an essential part of monotheism. That's the book that I know. I hear what he's saying. I think he's wrong.
There's this moment Jesus is in a discussion with a religious professional, a Jewish religious professional, as his day, and he asks this question, because they all know the Bible and Moses and all this stuff. And he asks the guy about scriptures, and he says this phrase I find entirely interesting. How do you read it? How do you read it? Because there's different ways to read it. I guess if you're gonna read the Bible and you're sort of a determined atheist, I guess you could read it like that. I don't necessarily think he's trying to like put it together.
Human beings have a tendency to become arrogant. You find these scientific theories and even scientific laws. Over a period of time, somebody else comes up and he comes up with a new theory, a law, whatever. Then the old one is discarded. All of these scientists and other philosophers, they come up, this came by chance. There was a big bang, or etc. Yeah. But it came from somewhere. There must have been something that initiated it. Of course, we cannot comprehend that.
Right.
That power that is beyond our comprehension. But it doesn't mean that, something that is beyond our comprehension doesn't exist. And I think as human beings, we ought to be a little bit more humble in our approach.
As science explains more and more, I think people are turning away from the outdated beliefs of churches. I think churches will evolve with the times and become more liberal, but look at the Anglican Church, split because of the homophobia within part of the Anglican Church. Young people now, they're reading about atheism and realizing that we're not scary, evil people, mm-hmm. baby eaters, that we're, there's been always like a stereotype of mm-hmm. us. So there's more information to understand about atheism. And like I was going with young kids aren't so homophobic anymore. And a lot of religions, I guess all the big three, are very homophobic. And people are saying, we don't want this. Your dogma is 3,000 years old, like get with the program. At least go up to 1625. No.
The big questions of Hindus right now is, do we, as the modern Hindu, have the wherewithal to impart our basic beliefs to the younger generation in a manner that they will accept it, since they are bombarded by all that is so different in the new world? That is the greatest challenge.
I'm an example of it, really. I was raised to be a practicing Hindu, and I'm not a practicing Hindu, and I think that's pretty much how the cookie crumbles right now for Hindus in the modern world. I mean, you see this kid who just came in here with his dad and stuff, and I'd be interested to see if he's here when he's, 15, 16, 17, especially if he's in the middle of Toronto, which is the school that I went to, where you're surrounded by all these different people with all these different views and all these different beliefs, and that stuff gets in there,
Judaism has managed to survive, although it has been, throughout almost all of history, a very tiny religion. And it is significantly less than 1% of the population of the world. It's only between 1% and 2% of the population of Canada, only slightly higher in the United States. And I worry in general about the survival of Judaism in North America because of the attraction of a secular agnostic society. It's a nice life here in North America, and there are many, many attractive things to living a life where of less responsibility.
We live in a consumeristic society, and that has absolutely affected the church, right? Multiple churches in town, we suffer under this, and you can start to get viewed like a product or a service. So people will shop you. If they don't like what you're saying, or maybe they don't like your approach, or maybe they don't like your leadership or something, they actually don't have to wrestle with that. They just go to another one. They just choose a different product. Let's take something like the Sabbath. Our culture here, Western culture, does not lend itself to rest very well, and it's getting worse, right? So now everything's open all the time, right? We've got the iPhones and the BlackBerries that are working all the time. We're connected all the time. Expectations are going up on when you're going to be connected and when you're going to be available. And so we don't rest. I bet you ask most Christians, say, do you believe that the Sabbath is a transferable spiritual principle? I bet you they'd say yes. Go ahead, try that. Go in church, just announce, say, Sunday's going to be we're going to have that as a Sabbath at our church. So no, everybody don't, no hockey, no soccer, no swim meets, no anything. And see what people say in the culture. See if they say that's a good idea. We're going to have no hockey and soccer with my kids on Sundays, and we're just going to lay low and make that God's day. Or see if they go to another church.
It's impossible to practice all aspects of one's religion entirely in a society where the overriding environment is either irreligious or non-religious, or a society where there are different religions. So some degrees of adjustments have to be made. An observant Muslim would not indulge in interest taking or interest giving.
Wow.
But what do we do here? You know, everybody has to buy a house. Everybody, even if, let's say, I as an individual Muslim do not want to take interest or give interest, I have no choice because I still have to put my money in the bank. And if I don't take interest on that money, the bank is taking interest,
right,
and my money is losing value.
Right.
And so we don't have any control over that situation. Religious organizations, whether they are Muslims or Christians or Jewish or Hindus or whatever religion, when they want to set up their organizations, they still have to get approval for their organizations from the secular authority. Although the overriding ethos of this society may be atheistic and secular, nobody in this society has said that there is no room for religion. Although I can see that there is an attempt to try to narrow the space in which religion can operate in this society. So we are gradually being boxed in.
There's a great effort being made by certain religious groups to convert people.
Mm-hmm.
Conversion, there are certain religious organizations that have a quota that we will convert that many million Indians this year.
Right.
So on that fact, yes, there is an impact. But although in the face of all of this, the Hindu believes that our way, if we continue to practice it, will influence others to accept their way of life rather than what we call a religion.
Why do Christians evangelize?
Well, the first thing is one of the teachings of Jesus, right? Go and make disciples of all nations. So it's one of his final instructions. But quite simply, too, if you feel like there's this disease that's been pulling down the human race and you thought you had the cure, wouldn't you tell everyone you knew?
You know what's funny? The bus campaign, when I did get death threats, but Justin and some other people got death threats, and we always knew if it was Muslim, it was like, we're going to come and kick your head off. If it was a fundamentalist Christian, it was like, you're going to go to hell. So we always knew where it was coming from. It was kind of funny. It's kind of a running joke. I've met Muslim people who are just, you know, amazing, obviously, just regular people of faith. But the media, I guess, plays up the extremists. And there are extremists.
Is there a danger for a Christian if a Christian were to not evangelize?
Danger in terms of judgment?
Some kind of punishment, yeah.
No, just not to focus on punishments necessarily. It would be create an interesting thing where you wouldn't want to tell anyone.
What Islam says is that you should convey this message of Islam to other people. Of course, not by force. You invite
right.
people. If people are free to choose or not to choose. If they don't choose, that's perfectly okay. But if they accept it, then that's, you know, that's something commendable. So definitely we convey the message of Islam to other people. We explain to them what Islam believes in, and we explain to them what it entails, what what the belief is, what responsibilities it entails, what are our obligations towards ourselves, to our family, to our parents, to our children, to our neighbors, to the community at large. So Islam talks about all of these things, and we convey this message to other people, of course.
So Hindus are not looking to overtly spread their faith. They're just basically hoping to be left to their own devices. Is that basically what you're saying?
Well, I think that's a good analysis of it, okay? But I would say from my perspective, I'm gonna do everything possible to spread Hinduism. I want to convince other people that it is a good thing and you can join and it's open. But the Swamis in India and the Rishis and the Munis, what we'll call the seers, say there's no need to do that. Mm-hmm. Let every man choose his way, and his way will ultimately lead him to the way. And the way is
your way.
I wouldn't say my way. The way is the way of life.
Buddhism has nothing to be afraid of, all these isms. Buddhism is Buddhism. Although we say, Buddhism, in fact, Buddhism is not an ism. Today, we tell people that I'm so-and-so. Why? To get attention, to enjoy some privileges. But this enlightened person has completely uprooted the ego, personality, identity. He's free from these things. And that's why, he's not bothered by anything. Although you hit him, although you say something, he's not disturbed. Why? Because his mind is free from these disturbances. He's not reacting, but responding. He's free.
The same way that you talk about morals being innate within us, violence too.
Yeah, it doesn't pick.
It's not spawn of any kind of belief.
Yeah, it doesn't pick what faith you are. No,
right.
It's just some people are psychotic, no matter if they're religious or not. It seems like religion lends itself to giving people seemingly the right to become violent. Their faith defines who they are and what the world is and their view of the world. So don't cross that, because that's something very dear to them. Look at in the Middle East, where Christians are being murdered by Muslims. It's the same God. It's insane. I think atheists have actually better morals than a lot of religious people.
God is there to help us live a moral life, and I'm grateful for the help of God and for the help of God's Torah in helping me to live a moral life. And I worry about those people who don't have a system of guidance. Some of them will come up with morality in their life anyways, and all the more power to them. That's great.
You study the entire Islamic history. Never, ever, ever will you find any instance in which the Muslims have perpetrated a genocide against the Jews. Never, ever. I challenge anybody to come and give us any proof or any evidence. Because why? Because Muslims always treated them as people of the book. And the same applies to Christians. Because Islam has certain rules and regulations of dealing with other people.
You were worried about the relationship between religion and violence, and I'm more concerned, to tell you the truth, about the relationship between atheism and violence.
Yeah, but the fear of God hasn't really stopped religious people from doing the things that they've done in history. If they were really fearful of going to hell, then why the hell have they caused so many wars? Whereas atheists have never done that. From a purely atheistic point of view, to spread the word of atheism, we have never caused any violence ever.
Things have gone terribly wrong. There's no question. I will not say that things that the church has done in history were right. There were things that were done that were wrong. You read the Bible, read the whole history of God's people going wrong and trying to get back on course. Read all the prophets trying to get them back on course. I feel we're not absolved from that now, which is why we have to constantly be focused on how God's leading and what he's doing to keep on course. And look what's happened in Germany with Dietrich Bonhoeffer and having to go underground. And where was the Christian church in Nazi Germany? and all these things. So there's no question that, that the church can get off track.
It isn't as if secularism is connected with fuzzy feelings of goodness and lovey-dovey feelings of loving all of humanity, while religion is into violence and going and kill. That's a great distortion of what is what's going on in this. And some of the other greatest violence of the 20th century was the violence that came from communism. Which was a worldview that had a certain imperialistic notion to it, also of wanting to take over the world. And this wasn't a religious worldview. It had some of the trappings of religion, but without God. Atheism was central to the communist worldview, and this did not turn them into more moral human beings.
I think sometimes we think like the private sector brings is has pure motives and things. It doesn't. In many cases, the corporations going overseas and the oil companies, they had pretty clear motives too, around what they were going to do and what they were going to take from these countries. And I'll point to certain countries in South America and Nigeria and other countries as well. So maybe we can all share the blame for our mistakes and just really use confession and repentance and try and be better.
People believed in all those other gods, right, centuries and thousands and thousands of years ago, as strongly as this one. They call this one God, but it's Yahweh. So there's Yahweh and Zeus and Odin and Horus and all the other different gods. So people worship this one as much as they used to worship all those other guys. It's like, they're all the same. They don't exist. It's just a pretend. Like, get over it. That's my feeling, anyways.
Journalism requires objectivity. Unfortunately, what I learned about religion is that it is a fundamentally subjective thing.
Everybody has such good points, such strong points, and such convincing arguments for whatever they believe in. I'm starting to think that maybe that's why there is so many agnostics. That's why if you ask the average person on the street what they believe in, they'll say, you know, I think it's a little bit of this, a little bit of that. I don't believe in Jesus, I don't believe in Buddha, but I believe that, you know, Jesus had this right and Buddha had this right, and so incorporate both those into my life, you know?
Buddhism is asking one question, a simple question. I was like, Sasha, are you okay? If I ask you this question, simple question, if you give me an honest answer, I'm a genuine honest answer to this simple question, you would say, sometimes I am, sometimes I'm not. Right? Yeah. So Buddhism is asking another question, do you know why you are not okay? What bothers you? What disturbs you? Right? So that is a problem. What if you say, I am not okay, that means you're acknowledging that you're living with this existential problem.
For so long, people have looked at atheists as almost not even human. So I think in Canada, we don't have quite that problem. I think as we're coming out and realizing that we're just regular human beings, we're trying to figure out our ways, we're trying to understand what the hell are we doing here? Where do we come from? Where are we going? None of us know. But I think atheists look at things and go, we don't know the answers. We're not going to say it's some father figure, some supernatural entity. We're as curious as every other person, any other human, to know what's it all about. And we just have a clear mind of saying we don't know, and we're looking for the truth. We're looking for knowledge. Whether or not we'll find it in our lifetime, probably not.
These people who are perhaps on the fence, what does Hinduism offer them?
Hinduism offers them an opportunity to think the way they think, but still relate to some divine power, to be spiritual. To be exact, Hinduism says you can be spiritual. And by the way, we live in a world where spirituality is becoming more popular than religion. A man who says, I don't believe in any religion, but I'm very spiritual. What does he mean? It means, I believe that there's something out there, but I don't want to call him Christ. I don't want to call him Ram or Buddha or any one of those things. I believe that that thing exists. And I believe that I'm part of that. But I don't want to follow your way or your way or your way or the way. I'll have my own way. That I don't believe in any one of those, but I believe. And that's the key. And I can give you this analogy, and it sounds maybe a little bit silly, but it's a reality. It's something that can relate. The man goes to Lion Safari, who's an atheist.
Right.
And he doesn't believe in God, and he's been convincing people all the time that there's no God.
Right.
He goes there and he gets into the vehicle and he drives around the farm, and you're told never to get out of your vehicle, but he gets out and walks around.
Right.
And lo and behold, he's confronted by a set of lions, all ready to jump on him. And immediately he says, oh God. Without thinking, he said, oh God, and lo and behold, everything stopped. And God appeared and says, you call? He says, you're real? He says, yes. He said, but I don't believe in you. He says, no, when you called, just now you did. You believe that, and I'm here. He said, but I don't believe in you. Being the atheist that he is, he said, well, look, you know, I don't believe in you, but since you say you're God, why don't you make all of these lions good Christians? So be it, the Lord says, and disappeared. Immediately, all the lions dropped on their knees and they started to pray. We thank thee, God, for that which we're about to eat. As such, the atheist will say he's an atheist. But when the real challenges of life are placed and is confronted by them, he stops to think in his mind without saying out, oh God, but in his mind saying, where are you now?
What would you say to somebody who is sitting on the fence, looking at both arguments, the argument for the existence of God, the arguments against the existence of God, and wondering what to think?
Am I speaking to somebody who is Jewish, or am I speaking to somebody who isn't Jewish?
Speak to somebody who is Jewish, and then speak to somebody who isn't.
Yes. If it's somebody who is Jewish, I would invite them to come to what I would hope would be a meaningful synagogue service, invite them to come to a Sabbath meal at my table, and try to show them that there is a beauty within our tradition, and there's a warmth, and that doing things that Jews traditionally did for many centuries and millennia is a meaningful way of living their life. Like all Jews today, I don't try to convert other people to Judaism. And when talking with somebody, to a seeker who would come to me who isn't a Jew, I would talk to them about religious philosophy.
Go on that journey. Go on that expedition. It's an exploration. There's an undiscovered country out there. That many of the tools that you're going to get are not going to get you, that science won't get you all the way there. You need to go on this expedition. One thing that worked for me was to actually read the Bible. Don't trust what other people say. Like, why don't you actually read that? Start with John. Try and see what Jesus said. There's a big problem between what people think Jesus said and what Jesus actually said. Even sometimes in the church. Find some Christians that you respect, that you can dialogue with, that you see who they seem to have some things working in their life. So I think the only way you fail is by not going on the journey, or just giving into what everything that our culture is pushing at you and pushing at what they feel is the life that they want you to live. Because our culture has a plan for your life too, right? There's a matrix that you're gonna get plugged into. Unplug from that and go forward and just start thinking, what do you think is true?
I believe that the contemporary world is suffering from a deep philosophical and ideological crisis. There is lack of spirituality. You know, people are so much driven by materialism and sort of, you know, advancement in the material field that they have lost track of their spiritual dimensions. And I believe that Islam offers a very good blend of both. And I quite honestly and genuinely believe that unless and until we as human beings stop chasing material goods and take some time for reflection and contemplation. People that have the greatest level of satisfaction, even among Muslims, are those that have this extended family network, right? Because they provide support to each other, right? Both at the times of, like, you know, marriages, but at the times of grief, like if somebody passes away, that there is some support mechanism provided. At the larger level, Islam's principles of fairness and justice, of compassion, of looking after the needs of other people, I think would go down very well in today's society. I mean, you know, even in Canada, I personally feel very distressed when I see so many homeless people. I mean, there is no reason for it. You know, I mean, I consider that to be my responsibility as well, as a Canadian, as a Muslim, that I should be helping those people.
Right.
My invitation would be, study Islam. Here is with an open mind. Accept it or reject it is your choice, but at least don't shut yourselves off completely from the study of Islam. Study it and see what it offers to humanity, what it says. Don't believe in what the media is telling you. Study for yourself. I mean, I have faith in everybody's intelligence, that they should be able to judge for themselves.
You have to engage in thinking, reflection, contemplation. And the salvation that you're trying to find is not out there. Salvation, liberation, and freedom all are here within. In fact, Buddhism is teaching us to overcome all views, all isms, all labels. Why? If you stick to isms, labels, your existential problem is going to become bigger and bigger, bigger and bigger.
Yeah.
So you have to let go.
I'm not convinced that there is no God, but if there is, he'd have to be bigger than my capacity to understand him. We live in a world where we want really firm answers. We want things to fit into a box. We want formulas. While these beliefs have similarities, I don't think it's possible to get a deeper understanding of life simply by piecing them together in my own little puzzle. There must be a right way and a wrong way to approach God.
How do you know? I mean,
how do you know,
you talk about Jesus as though he's like right here. A lot of the time, that's the sense that I get.
Yeah.
And, you know, how do you know? How do you know? Where does that sort of come from? I mean...
Yeah. Well, I've had some experiences. Right. Jesus would say, you can't see the wind, but you definitely can feel it. So how do you know there's wind? Oh, I feel it. I feel it all my life. So you can become this kind of person that he describes in the Sermon on the Mount. It's possible.
All religions came into being in this planet to teach the good path. And the good path to the heaven. If you believe in the kingdom of God, again, you need these basic human qualities to have a rebirth in the kingdom of God.
I don't think that anybody has the market cornered on theology. I think it would be ignorant for me to say that. I've come to believe that God has a plan, and that we're a part of it. After making this film, I've come to realize that I've only just put my toes in the water. There's much more to see, and to hear, and to understand. Religion is just a pond.
God is an ocean.